Hello. We're going to get started. We have a very exciting afternoon panel. And before postprandial stupor sets in, we want you all to be active and energized because we are going to have a lot of time for discussion. I could not be happier than to introduce to you our keynote speaker for this panel, and then I'll also briefly introduce our two panelists who are going to respond to our keynote, Dr. Carl Dieffenbach. And then he will have a chance to respond to them, and then we will have time for your questions and answers. So this is a very exciting panel because it's going to discuss the current state and future prospects for biobehavioral HIV prevention. Our keynote speaker, Dr. Carl Dieffenbach, is trained as a basic scientist and has done some exemplary work on herpes simplex and other herpes virus pathogenesis, but has over the years assumed leadership positions at the NIH and has been the director of the Division of AIDS for quite a number of years and has overseen many of the landmark studies that he's going to describe to you today that really have changed the whole paradigm for how we might think about controlling the AIDS epidemic. He'll be followed by Dr. Adimora. Dr. Adimora is an infectious disease specialist and a professor of medicine at the University of North Carolina. She's also the chair of the board of directors of HIVMA at the present time and has been national leader making sure that the benefits of the new technologies accrue to women and people from communities of color. And she'll be followed by Phill Wilson, and Phill is the president, CEO, the founder of the Black AIDS Institute, and has been a national leader really trying to focus our attention on the epidemic for the needs of all the different diverse communities in the Black African American community, other communities of color, and particularly with the focus on men who have sex with men. So without further ado, Dr. Dieffenbach, we look forward to your comments.
Thank you, Ken. It's a pleasure to be your after lunch speaker, and I will try to keep my remarks short. It is a pleasure to talk to you about prevention and where we are headed, but I want to make a couple of remarks to start with. I'm going to focus primarily on the domestic situation, because that's, I think, the appropriate place to be for this meeting. And I'm not going to talk about prevention of perinatal transmission. It's not that I don't think it's important, but I can't cover everything I need to cover in the time that I have. No talk from the NIH would be complete if I didn't show a budget slide. This is de rigueur. They staple it to you as you leave every day so that you are reminded that, in fact, we have the things that I'm going to talk about and the successes that we have achieved over the last 10 years have been done with level funding. And that's a credit to the creativity of the researchers here in this room and around the country and around the world for the things I'm going to discuss. So basically, the NIAID funding has been constant at about $4.6 billion. HIV AIDS represents approximately a third of that funding. So in terms of the NIAID and Division of AIDS strategic goals, it is I want to indicate to you that where we are today is highly focused on accomplishing some very specific things. We know a lot. We know how HIV spreads. And as such, we can then move forward and develop interventions that can block transmission in terms of developing a safe and effective HIV vaccine, improve combination prevention strategies, optimize treatment, and work on therapeutic strategies toward a cure. And as such, with those activities, combined with the idea of fostering partnerships with scientific and community stakeholders, we can really have a profound impact on the epidemic. So you can see our priorities as a division are prevention, including a safe and effective HIV vaccine, as well as biomedical strategies that are safe and desirable. Because I think uptake and use is really the major challenge that we face. We need to develop improved treatments and work toward a cure. We need to also then deal with the comorbidities and co-infections that are still influencing the lives of the people who are HIV infected, both domestically and internationally, and then foster these partnerships. All of this ties to the President's National HIV/AIDS Strategy. This is really a good place to start in terms of we really need collectively to develop the tools that can reduce incidence. We need to be able to increase access to care and optimize health outcomes. And for HIV-positive people, that means addressing the continuum of care, getting everybody who's HIV-infected identified, get people into care, get them linked into care, get them on antiretrovirals, and get them fully suppressed. And then for the other, the remaining comorbidities, we really need to work on reducing HIV-related health disparities. And here's where the hepatitis comes in. We have had a sea change in the United States and around the world. Hepatitis is now a curable disease. We need to figure out how to fully take advantage of the tools that have been developed and really start working on an elimination strategy for hepatitis. And we can use hepatitis as the colleagues I have in the drug abuse world will talk about gateway drugs. Let's use the hepatitis drugs as a gateway drug to get people into care, get them a victory, and get them then to, once they have their hepatitis is under full control, move them into durable suppression for their HIV. So I'm going to talk about a couple of, I think, are landmark game changers. My colleague Mike Cohen refers to HPTN-052 as the gift that just keeps on giving. And it really has. If you think about what we saw, full durable suppression of HIV leads to an elimination or a virtual elimination of linked transmissions. This is a major breakthrough. But then the debate was, how do you use therapy if it only benefits a partner? Well, we have just recently completed the START study. This study is going to be a landmark study in and of its own. We had over 4,500 people participating in the study. The study stopped before at a point approximately 60% of the data was available. That's how robust the finding was. It was done in 35 countries, and it showed at the time of unblinding that the reduction of death or illness was significant in the early group compared to the deferred arm. The other thing that was in the press release that may have been missed is this result was incredibly robust. It didn't matter if you were in sub-Saharan Africa or in Europe or the United States, and it didn't matter if you were a woman or a man. It was consistent across socioeconomic groups as well as gender. It's pretty spectacular. So we're no longer have a debate as to whether or not therapy matters or what CD4 count. No matter what your CD4 count is, therapy will have an effect. This is really a game changer. It really puts the pressure then on the continuum of care. Because who would benefit the most from starting antiretroviral therapy? It's people who are relatively newly infected. And if you think about the long-term consequences on the healthcare system, if somebody starts therapy early and gets treated and stays suppressed, you reduce potentially this huge amount of comorbidity that is ultimately a cost savings. And so we really need some really good mathematical modeling on what this could have in terms of a profound impact, and then the cost-benefit ratio of getting people started early, not just for 1 year, but for 5 or 10 years, and the impact of that on the healthcare system. So treatment isn't opposed to prevention. Treatment is prevention as we move forward. But then we are left with the typical conundrum we have for all chronic diseases. We have a problem with adherence. And how do we get people to value staying adherent to their medication? How can we create social desirability around HIV therapy so that it is a badge of honor to take your medication if you are HIV infected, and it's a badge of honor and you are rewarded in the community for being adherent? I think this is a real challenge that as we talk about the importance of biomedical and behavioral interactions, this is probably one of the most important ones that we have to address. So rather than go into a litany about the types of research the NIH is supporting, I want to provide to you a reason why I am so optimistic about the future of HIV treatment and care and prevention, not just in the United States, but around the globe. And I think this is the most optimistic I've been since I've been at the Division of AIDS, and here is why. I think that an HIV vaccine is within our grasp. I think some of the vaccines we have in trial now will show an increased level of efficacy. Whether or not they reach a level of efficacy that they could be then rolled out globally, I don't know. But they will have efficacy, and that we will then be able to build a generation of vaccines within the next 5 to 10 years that will truly have an impact on the epidemic. I think that with microbicides and pre-exposure prophylaxis, they will find a niche, particularly as we move forward with sustained release formulations. And the sustained release formulations are not necessarily just the first generation we have in trial right now, but in second and third generations that are already in development by pharmaceutical companies. I used a slide similar to this at the Rome meeting and talked about sustained release and long acting. I had several drug companies come up to me at that meeting and say, you are crazy. There is no way this is ever going to work. You know what? It's the same executives who took me to task at that meeting that are now coming and knocking on my door and saying, will you test our product? So that's a testament to at least being crazy enough to speak your mind. We also have to then be able to understand the roles that these broad neutralizing antibodies, we have 74 isolated and characterized broad neutralizing antibodies that have been identified. 7 years ago, we had 4. We have an armamentarium that needs to be tapped to figure out how we can utilize these molecules. Through the use of long-acting and sustained-release formulations, I think the therapeutic armamentarium is going to continue to improve to a point where, over the next several years, we could reduce the delivery of therapy to an event that occurs between 4 and 12 times a year. Not a pill a day, but quarterly. Now, that would be a game changer, not just domestically, but for the world as seen by the need to deliver therapy in PEPFAR. PrEP will also follow suit. And then you have solved one component of the adherence problem. You will still need to be able to get people back into care so that they can continue to take their doses. But with these tools, we can really help to begin to control the HIV pandemic. Let's talk a little bit about implementation, because clearly what we also continue to need to do is, even with the START results, we have an issue with how do we make therapy available. We need to be able to improve the implementation of existing regimens for both treatment and prevention. Some examples of the kinds of activities the NIH has pursued in this area are, we have ongoing cluster randomized trials of the delivery of antiretroviral therapy in collaboration with PEPFAR. We've also worked very carefully and closely with PEPFAR on the development of better strategies for adult male circumcision. And we've also worked with them on capacity building. Domestically, the ideal partnership for implementation science is to work with the implementing partners, whether it is the CDC or the health departments. And the NIH has had city-focused programs as well as programs with the CDC to look at ways of improving the continuum of care, as well as looking at behavioral interventions. We also participated in a program that helped enhance the research arm of the eCHIP program at CDC. So in summary, in just a few minutes, I wanted to lay out a big picture vision of where the NIH is in terms of supporting research that can have a profound impact on the epidemic. It is highly biomedical, but it is essential that we have the behavioral and social science research components so that we can understand how to create desire, how to create demand for these products, and ultimately work with our federal partners at reducing HIV-related healthcare disparities. Thank you for your attention.
Peter? Ada, would you like to respond?
Can you hear me? It is on. Thanks. So thanks for inviting me. My remarks are mainly focused on biomedical prevention in the domestic arena, as Carl said. And these aren't what I thought I would do, rather than sort of, you know, rehashing the current state of PrEP for women, pre-exposure prophylaxis for women. I thought what I would do would be to actually pose a series of questions. And these aren't necessarily all to you, Carl, because I don't know that they're all even in your purview. But they're really
what to me are some have been some thorny questions that have persisted during the course of my work with HIV prevention. And so just as general thoughts for many of us, here are some questions. Other than women in discordant partnerships with men who have unsuppressed HIV infection, many commercial sex workers and perhaps some transgender women, who are the women in the U.S. who should take PrEP? I mean, who are they, especially given current risk benefits and efficacy issues? What psychosocial, and by that I mean personal and relationship issues, and certainly also economic factors, are likely to influence women's adherence to PrEP? Some of these questions apply to men as well. A huge question has been, particularly for women in the U.S., including those who are at significant risk, is how can we even determine the efficacy of a lot of these interventions in the populations in which they are to be used, in settings in the U.S. where there are certainly huge racial disparities in HIV infection, but where even among women at high risk, although the seroincidence is relatively high, it's still too low to permit the conduct of randomized controlled trials without enrolling 10,000 women, which is likely not to be feasible. Another question to me is, you know, is it reasonable, really, even to assume that an intervention that has demonstrated efficacy in one population, say in sub-Saharan Africa, will be effective in a completely different female population if the intervention requires adherence? That is, if it requires the person to do anything more than once, like take pills every day or even go back for injections every 3 months. How do you know that the effectiveness will be the same as the efficacy that was demonstrated in another population? And is it reasonable to assume that it'll be the same? Another question is, you know, it seems likely to me that different women will likely want different types of PrEP products in all likelihood. Some will want pills, some will want topical things like rings, some will prefer injectables, particularly long-acting injectables. Some will want products that provide contraception. Some will want products that don't, so they can maintain their fertility. Some will want products that protect against other STIs other than just HIV. And so a question that I have is, will the pharmaceutical industries be willing to invest in product research and development given the possibility that no single product will likely dominate the market? I mean, and so what is the meaning? And what implications are there? Another thing is, you know, we spend a lot of time, and I think these are honest questions. I don't say that I've thought about some of these things, but I don't necessarily have the answers. How we spend a lot of time asking people what they would like, which I think is a good idea, but in the final analysis, how accurately can you determine people's preferences for products that don't yet exist and whose side effects are currently unknown? I mean, how much can you assume that people will really, I mean, people have a sort of hypothetical impression of what they would like, but it may be completely different for once the product actually exists. It may feel funny or feel good. It may have side effects that they didn't anticipate, et cetera. And finally, you know, in terms of, well, I think I'll stop there. End of my question.
All right. Phil, would you like to comment?
Sure. Actually, I'm going to go to the, because I don't know how to do the slides from there. So, well, first of all, thank you, Carl, for those comments. And I have a number of thoughts. Over lunch, Mike Cohen asked me if I was optimistic about where we are and about the progress that we're making. And like a good CEO, my answer was yes and no. I have an interesting experience in that I spent a lot of time in the research arena.
know, sitting on panels and advocating about research and looking at research and thinking about research, even though I'm not a scientist. But my day job, now, is really about what happens with that research. Maya Angelou said, when we know better, we do better. When we know better, we do better. And as Carl laid out, you know, as a result of a lot of the scientific breakthroughs that we've had in the last 10 years, and I would actually argue over the last 5 years, you know, in a huge way, we've had some game changers, some quantum leaps. And there's some things that we know. We know the impact of treatment as prevention, as Carl laid out. We know that, you know, we can, if we help people who are living with HIV get on treatment, we can break the back of transmission. We also know that we should start immediately, that there are benefits for starting people on treatment when they're diagnosed. We also know that we can have a dramatic impact on acquisition through PrEP. But then the question is, when we talk about what we know, who are we? And so I'd like to share with you an experience that I had last night. I attended the STEP Africa Gala here in town. STEP Africa is the largest, you know, professional step dance company in the country. And so this gala was full of, you know, black folks who can afford to go to an expensive gala and actually respond after they paid tickets to give $1,000 or $2,000 to this event. It was not to be stereotypical, but it was a dance gala, so there are lots of gay men there. And so I had a conversation with a guy who lives on 118th and Lenox in Harlem. No, very well educated, openly gay, in a relationship with children, and pretty knowledgeable, and he lives in Harlem. And so we're talking about what I do, and we're talking about some of the issues around, you know, treatment as prevention, and I talked about prevention without mentioning PrEP, and he says, you know, I have friends who are in merge relationships, you know, where one is positive and one is negative, you know, and we talk about some of the strategies some of the issues that they have. And I said, well, you know that if the positive person is on treatment and the negative person is also on treatment, sometimes they can be the same treatment. Actually, we can reduce transmission by possibly up to 96%, and we can reduce acquisition by possibly up to over 90%. And he says, really? And he says, what is that? And I said, it's called PrEP. He says, oh, PrEP. I heard of that. I had no idea what it was. So when we know better, we do better, but we need to focus on how we're defining we. Earlier this year, the Black AIDS Institute released a study on the knowledge, attitudes, and beliefs of people working on HIV. And what we discovered in the study is that there are a lot of us, who are questions about what we know. So in the study, there are over 3,600 respondents from 48 states, Washington, D.C., and U.S. territories. We did a pilot at USCA, and then we did a national rollout, and then we did a special initiative with the states, you know, partnering with NASDAQ and the Latino Commission on AIDS and CDC. And so it's a pretty robust study, and this is what we found. That we found that on average, the HIV science and treatment literacy of folks who are working in HIV, this is not general population, this is not the guy who lives on 118th and Lenox, is somewhere between 61% and 63%, with a median score of only 64%. And when we looked at the overall score, we saw that people on average scored around a D, if this was an academic setting, and only 4% of folks who are working in HIV would have scored an A, or 90% or above. In some of the areas that we looked at, people did better than in others. In basic knowledge and terminology, folks on general scored around a 73 to 76%. But when we look at some of the critical issues that we need to talk about if we, in fact, are going to get to the end game, and that's knowledge about treatment, the average score was about 54%. When we looked at clinical and biomedical interventions, the average score was only about 45%. Again, if this is an academic setting, an F. Again, these are folks who are working in HIV, working in health departments, working in AIDS service organizations, working in community-based organizations, working in clinical settings. Non-medical providers, I want to be clear about that. We only survey people who are non-medical providers, so no doctors or nurses or PAs or nurse practitioners. But these are the folks who are going to deliver the message that Carl talked about adherence. And they actually don't know, we don't know what we need to know if we're going to deliver the message. So the best interventions in the world don't really mean a damn if we don't understand them and are not committed to using them. So the other thing we want to look at is how familiar are people in the AIDS workforce with biomedical interventions? We discovered that nearly 50% of folks who are working in HIV are not familiar with biomedical interventions. Our study ended in 2013, so we think that there have probably been some improvements, at least on PrEP, since the study. But when we looked at PrEP, when we looked at vaccines, when we look at treatment as prevention, huge portions of the HIV/AIDS workforce were not familiar with them. And even worse, up to 30% of folks working in HIV did not believe in them, did not believe that they would work or do work, which is a challenge. So we have an AIDS workforce that don't understand biomedical interventions, are not familiar with biomedical interventions, and don't believe that they work. Now, we did notice that there was a significant difference between those who were familiar and those who knew, the more familiar you were, both the higher your knowledge scores were and the more likelihood that you would believe in them. The study was not designed to tell us what was the chicken and what was the egg, but there was that correlation. And so the challenge in what we do really has to address how do we do a better job of not being an echo chamber, not being excited as I am, and I run around and run around and I talk about we have the tools to end the AIDS epidemic. And some of that excitement is because I spend so much of my time with you all. When I spend more time with the folks who are going to have to take these medications and do something with their lives about it, I'm not so excited. And so figuring out how we connect the dots between these various populations will be critical in that regard. Just a final information, the messenger matters, region of the country matters. We discovered that there are differences also depending on where you were in the country. And I think this will be my last slide on this issue, that folks who lived in Ohio, Pennsylvania, Maryland, Missouri, and the District of Columbia did better. Folks who live in Arizona, Texas, Florida, Georgia, and North Carolina, particularly the bottom four states, Texas, Florida, Georgia, and North Carolina, it's kind of interesting when we look at what's happening with expansion of the Affordable Care Act and what's happening with gay marriage and what's happening with a whole lot of social issues. There's a connection going on in those places. And so the biggest challenge, I think, for us, we are getting the game changers, they're happening. The problem is that they're not being translated and delivered in the places where we actually are going to see the change, as Mike Cohen put it, that matter. And that is significant changes in new HIV infections and significant clinical improvement for folks who are living with HIV and AIDS. The last thing that I want to talk about, and then I'll shut up, is kind of one of the things that we observe in the work that we're doing is that in many ways, the good news is that many of the pieces that are necessary to get the job done, they're there. But the problem is that they're not connected. They're just these series of activities that are not folded together. And so one of the things that we're looking at is how do you actually develop a framework that actually gets you from the beginning to the end, where you actually can drive down and have major improvement along the treatment cascade. So our motto is called STTR, seek, test, treat, and retain. And it's about looking at networks in communities, seeing who the players are, and creating a structure in which they actually work together in a seamless way. And so beginning at identifying the unidentified, undiagnosed positives in the community and those previous diagnosed that have fallen out of care, and putting all those efforts to do that in a community together, networking and talking to each other. That's the seek aspect. Then obviously driving people to testing, but targeted testing. But in particularly in marginalized communities, we need to remember that we still need to do work around testing awareness and normalizing testing. Now, and so general large events testing is still important in communities that have not adopted the notion of HIV testing. And then providing red carpet, you know, linkage to care and treatment no matter where you are. And throughout the throughout the systems within a community. And then most importantly, in our mind, as one might think based on who we are, is to make sure that the systems are peer, that involve peers and folks who are living with HIV at every step of the way. Now, at the testing point, that there are people who are embedded in the testing process that are living with HIV, that there are people who are embedded in the linkage to care process, that there are people who are embedded in the retention process, and all those steps, making sure that peers are intricately involved in those processes. So those are some of our thoughts around kind of where we are, how we kind of marry the tremendous advances that we've had in the research arena, but making sure we connect them on the ground so that, you know, so that I no longer have to have and continue to get these calls that I continue to get that break my heart every time of folks who are finding out that they're HIV positive and they have end-stage AIDS, or even worse, the calls like I got just the other day of yet another black gay man who had died from HIV/AIDS. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ada, and thank you, Phil, for very trenchant comments. So, Carl, would you like to respond? I think you just speak into it.
Go to the microphone.
Okay.
So I think there's a very interesting dichotomy between my talk and what you've heard from Phil and Ada. So I tend to work in an ivory tower. And they're in the real world. And I think that this issue of health literacy is an essential challenge, not just in HIV, but you think about cardiovascular disease. 30% of all cardiovascular disease presents as sudden death. So this is a fundamental problem across the spectrum of diseases. I think the most important point that Ada kept making was we can measure efficacy and effectiveness in some populations. Does that translate across all populations, all geographic areas? And I would argue that being a reductionist, that antiretroviral therapy has been shown to work in all populations. There's no inherent human genetic resistance to any of the therapies, and so as such, you would make the argument that, by and large, a biomedical intervention that's based on therapy should work in women. Now, that said, there is some data that maybe Truvada doesn't work as well in women compared to men. And that's why we absolutely need to work toward what I refer to as a method mix. Ada is absolutely right. We need pills aren't good for everybody, injections aren't going to be good for everybody, gels aren't going to work for everybody, nor are vaginal rings. We're going to need to create a spectrum of prevention tools that women can then pick and choose from. And I think that that's going to be an essential part of what we continue to push on from a research perspective. I mean, there's just no way. I mean, think about what we have for contraception. We have a range of options, and we still probably don't have enough. We have implants, we have pills, and we have intrauterine devices. So we are in a place where we're not as good as we could be We at least have some tools that we can start to implement. But unless we solve this issue of education and rely, I mean, it really comes down to the doctor's offices, PSAs from the CDC and others, we need to be able to figure out how to use these tools and roll them out. I think it's these are all outstanding comments, and it gives us the impetus to move forward and implement what we have in combination with the partnerships with CDC, with HRSA, not just federal partners, but also with state and local health departments, as well as the healthcare sector. So I guess the question, Ken, is do we want to take questions from the audience, or do we want to have Ada and Phill make a couple more additional remarks?
If either of you have comments, but I think we're moving to that phase where people want to come to the microphones and direct.
I do have one comment.
Please.
I appreciate what you said, of course, Carl. I think the question that I'm raising is to what extent we certainly need to determine the efficacy of an intervention. Another issue is that another important question is the intervention's effectiveness, and adherence is part of the effectiveness, and adherence is determined by a series of factors related to the individual and their perception of risk and why they ought to do what you're telling them to do and their environment. And so I don't know, I think it's a real question whether you can simply stop and say, we have determined that this intervention is efficacious. I think we need to also determine whether it's effective. And that is part of the problem.
Yeah, so I guess, what I struggle with is that a study? And I think back to other disease states. Let's take osteoporosis, which also requires a degree of adherence to medication that's monthly or weekly. And at the end of the day, how do we determine whether it's effective? Mm-hmm. I mean, you basically go back to the doctor, you have a second bone scan, and your scan either has improved or it hasn't. But do we need studies in every population? If we know that adherence is an issue, shouldn't we be able to somehow track, without necessarily everybody giving consent, but through some sort of system, as well as foster adherence? Mm-hmm. I mean, I guess what I'm struggling with is, at one point, does it become the responsibility of the treating physician or the treating health department to make sure that they give the right messages so people utilize the medications the way they were prescribed? And where is the social responsibility of the individual? And is it really, or do we have to go to a DOT model where essentially things are being monitored on a fairly frequent basis? I don't know. I don't know the answer to these questions.
Right.
And I think we probably need a range of options depending on the community and the question. I just don't know.
Or how do we build a community of practice that supports what we know is effective?
That gets back to your point, Phill, about what we need to do is train the peer educators so that there is almost, it's in a given practice, there's a peer that will call and say, how are you doing? Are you remembering? You know, what is going on in your life that is preventing you from this? But that is where, you know, this becomes a healthcare utilization, and we really have to pursue these kinds of questions.
Yeah, and this whole idea of implementation science and program science, I think, is very much about that translation into the real world, because how you do it right, how you do it best, there's a whole science behind that. And again, one size will not fit all, but we have some people at the mic, so please, a person at the first mic.
We'll do them in order.
Thank you. My name is Stacy Boland. I'm a member of the Sault Ste. Marie Tribe of Chippewa Indians in Michigan. I'm the executive director of the National Indian Health Board and the former chairman of the board of the National Native American AIDS Prevention Center. And my question or my comment is, the place where this doesn't work is where it's not available. And where it's not available is where funding and support is not there to build the capacity of the tribes to have these kind of treatments, knowing better, doing better, outreach and education in Indian country. Some of our populations are acquiring HIV faster than anyone else on earth, and this has got to stop. So I just really wanted to make the comment that when SEBA funds are no longer available for American Indians, Alaska Natives specifically, when programs are not looking at the social responsibility of the health system and of all of us people of conscience to ensure that American Indians and Alaska Natives have access to these programs, the outcome is predictable. We die. Thank you. McWitch.
Thank you. I don't know if there's a response from the panel.
I disagree. Vicki.
Hi, Vicki Cargill, NIH. Certainly wonderful remarks. I wanted to sort of amplify on something that Phill said, and I think it also touches with Ada. And this whole question of how you build this social and community response such that it is considered a badge of honor. One of the things I think that we have perhaps started to do but could do more of is learning from other disease states. I think about Latino communities and diabetes and the role of the promotoras. And promotoras have done very well in those communities. I know, Phill, that you're doing some of this kind of work. But I think one of the things that we have to look at is not only having community-based individuals that are part of the practice, but it's one thing to have them as part of the practice, and it's another thing to be part of the practice where they are recognized as a critical, important, cogent piece of that practice. And that's reflected in everything from how we refer to them to even how we fund them when we have our awards. So I think that that's another aspect of trying to build that sense of community where people have a sense of obligation and responsibility, and they have multiple models in HIV and other disease states. And I would encourage us to continue to ramp that up.
Thank you.
So, Carl, a question for you. Given that we have these two highly effective prevention interventions, early initiation of treatment and pre-exposure prophylaxis, do you have any sense of the guidance that might come out vis-a-vis prioritizing which intervention when thinking about people in discordant couples?
That's a really good question. Well, it used to be it was easier to say that treatment would work best because essentially you get the benefit to the individual. I think treatment will always in some ways win out because it's treatment to the individual and then treatment would then prevent HIV transmission. I think the interesting thing is from the START data, treatment is unbelievably safe in terms of side effects and outcomes. I think the risk still of potential side effects for Truvada and other pills may still trump that. I think that's why continuing work on long-acting and safer forms of PrEP will matter. So again, I think it's not a one-size-fits-all, and I think that's where it has to be a conversation. You know, you run a wonderful healthcare facility in Boston, and I would expect you would be counseling your healthcare providers to, where possible, counsel the discordant couple about what would work best for them. Let's start having the conversations along the lines of what Phill and Ada have called for.
Absolutely. I'm surprised that there's not other people up at the mics. There's always a myriad of things I can ask Carl, but we certainly want to hear what's on other people's minds.
Well, they can ask
as well.
Ada and Phill, too. I'm the only one up here.
That's for sure. And actually, vis-a-vis Ada and Phill, if you had your magic wand, which populations in the communities where you're doing most of your work do you think you could have the most impact in changing people's knowledge, attitude, and engagement with the healthcare system around these new prevention treatment technologies?
Can anyone guess what I would say? Black MSM. And I think that for two reasons, actually, and thank you for that question, Ken, that clearly we are not going to get this job done if we're not successful among Black MSM, you know, and then we can extend beyond that to the larger Black and the larger people of color and the larger marginalized communities. But Black MSM is for three reasons, actually. Number one, that's where we have to start. That's where the biggest challenge in the epidemic is. Number two, it is, quite frankly, a community that is hungry for this to happen. We run a program called our African American HIV University, and we have 62 applicants for our year-long program that we can only take 30 folks. a program that, quite frankly, not actually calling out names, but when we go to funders, they say no one will want to come to that program. That it's too long, it's too intense, it's too tough. Now, and we have two applicants for every seat that we have. You know, no. So there's a hunger for that. And number three, there actually is an infrastructure if you work with the infrastructure. You know, there is a black gay infrastructure in America. There are organizations, there are communities, there are leaders, there's a way to build those relationships. And so for those three reasons, I think that, you know, it's a no-brainer.
Well, can I put in a friendly amendment? I agree with you, but just a slight amendment. And, you know, certainly I agree that the black young, but particularly young black MSM population is of critical importance. There's no question. So I agree with you. However, I also would like to put in a plug for making U.S. black women also a key population for HIV prevention efforts. And the reason is that although the incidence of infection among black women is thankfully substantially lower than it is among black men, it is nevertheless about tenfold higher, at least, than it is among white women. And that simply is not right. And it has been that way for decades. I actually think that this should be considered an urgent situation. And, you know, the question is, what do you do? Because I spend a lot of time arguing with people and sort of hectoring people about this. But, you know, what do you do about it? Well, I mean, my view is, and I can't address the issue of how do you engage the community. I leave that to you, because I know you know how to do that. But, you know, I think that clearly U.S. black women need to be included in all phases of research for biomedical, HIV prevention products. Research should not, and I'm not saying that they are not, but I want to reinforce that. This research should not be restricted to women in extraordinarily high incidence countries. We need to be included in all phases of research. Understanding, of course, that not all U.S. black women are equally at risk. I mean, obviously, that's clearly not true. The difficulty is, it is difficult to determine exactly who is at risk. There, I mean, we sort of see through a glass darkly. I mean, it is difficult to predict. There are certainly parameters that indicate higher risk, but we cannot tell perfectly. I do also think that new methods need to be developed to address this question. I mean, yeah, I agree with you, Carl, about the issues related to efficacy, but I think that that effectiveness also needs to be tested, and that's critically important. And I think that an intermediate step, actually, while we're solving this sort of methodologic problem, is to really do research on perhaps surrogates of HIV incidence. And those probably will not be, I doubt that STIs will be a good surrogate, because not all STIs are necessarily in the pathway for HIV. And I doubt that behavioral measures will necessarily be good surrogates either. I don't know what will be good surrogates. I'm saying what I think is that this is an issue for research.
And I think that the beauty of what Ada is talking about is that there is lots of evidence that you can actually get a twofer in this particular situation. For example, we're doing a big event at the Essence Festival in New Orleans. Essence magazine, the largest black women's magazine in the country, they do an annual festival. And at that event, we actually test over 1,000 people at that event. But we also use it as a way to both access black women and talk about HIV, but this year we're also doing a major panel at the forum to talk about the role that black women play in helping young black MSMs address HIV. So you can do a twofer in that situation. They're not mutually exclusive, mm-hmm. And that's kind of the beauty of kind of how relationships and communities actually work. So
absolutely.
You're right.
So Sheldon and then Sean.
Yeah, hi, Sheldon Morse from UCSD. I think I want to just add in a little bit more about PrEP, because I think there is a lot more research that we do that we can still do with Truvada. For example, and I'm sure Ken, you could give your experience, but I have a study of 400 MSM transgender on PrEP in Southern California, and it was, people were demanding it. It was very much in demand. I can say our adherence has been very high, but we don't have the final answer. But, there's some of the things that you need to do in the research is, like, we're doing text messaging for adherence, which turns out to be pretty effective, low tech because everybody has a phone. And so the research can still be done about how to get that. But then I want to echo what Dr. Adimora was saying, because, what we're really looking right now at is very soon probably expanding to include a cohort of women. And I went to I did a CAB on, I think maybe it was last week, I'm losing track of time, but I was trying to get, where do we find transgender and women at risk of HIV in San Diego? And I had our women providers there, and I came away with not really knowing how do I find women at risk who would want PrEP. And so I know you said that in your question, Dr. Adimora, and I think we still need to figure out those things of where we find these people and how do we implement these things and get experience to, how effective it is here in the United States.
Yeah. Well, a comment about your first point. I mean, the trials with the development of knowledge is really somewhat cyclical and iterative. So, I mean, in the initial trials, I always say the informed consent only a lawyer could love. I mean, we were telling people, this may not work. You may be getting something that can't work. And if you're getting the active thing, it might hurt you. So some of the disengagement in some of the communities is, somewhat understandable, as much as the investigators try to get people whose primary motivation is altruism. They're clearly in some of the studies around the world, that wasn't the only motivation for the study. What some of us are seeing in some of the early projects now, where you're, particularly if you're marrying an evidence-based adherence intervention, so whether it's cognitive behavioral therapy, we've done some work in Boston, the work that you're doing with text messaging, actually the rates of adherence are quite high. But what we're the phase we're in now is the early adopters, and the early adopters mm-hmm. don't necessarily look like the individuals who might most benefit from the epidemic, and that's where we really have to start moving the research. So I don't know, Ada, if you want to comment about Sheldon's comment about women and other populations' engagement.
Well, actually, what I was thinking about while you were talking is your last remark, and sort of I was wondering, what does PROUD, the PROUD trial, what implications does that have for women? I mean, in some of these studies, there has been a legitimate concern that maybe the results were in part not that good because of the information that people were given, that the level of risk, also the fact that they might be getting placebo. What would in fact happen if you put it in some of these settings into the community, as some of these other studies did, that had actually excellent results? And so, that's just a question.
Yeah, no. So PROUD, what you're asking about PROUD then is that in the British genitourinary medical clinic system, where people are going in, they know they're either going to be on a wait list or they're getting PrEP, very high levels of adherence and high levels of efficacy. So you're questioning whether that might be translatable to genitourinary medicine clinics in the U.S. or for women?
For women. However, the incidence among women is I think statistically it would be difficult to do. But the general principle of, you know that you're getting something real, you're being told that it likely works, you don't have 5 million caveats about what's going to happen to you, might the efficacy, the adherence, and therefore the effectiveness be different in such a setting?
Definitely a testable hypothesis. Sean.
Hi, Sean Cahill from the Fenway Institute in Boston. I had two questions. One, I wondered if any of you could comment on the issue of medical mistrust as a barrier to uptake of PrEP, particularly there's been a number of papers recently, and one of them was looking at black MSM and talked about race-based medical mistrust as a barrier to uptake of PrEP or just learning about PrEP. And then the other related issue, we did some focus groups at the Open Arms Health Center in Jackson, Mississippi, about a year ago, and mostly with young black gay men. And the majority of them, I think it was about two-thirds, were not in care, hadn't seen a primary care provider in the last 12 months, didn't have health insurance. So that's obviously a priority population that's just not connected to care. And how can we increase their access to primary health care at a basic level where they can learn about these new HIV prevention options?
Well, first of all, that's a plenary, so I'm not sure if we can address it in response to the question. But, you know, I think that on the issue around mistrust, there's a few things. One is I think that particularly among young black MSMs is less specific than mistrust of medical providers and more of a mistrust of authority in that regard. So it's broader than that. And secondly, you know, we have such a huge percentage of the population that, as you pointed out, doesn't have access at all. You know, and so we aren't even getting folks to a point where they could actually have an experience to develop trust or a mistrusting relationship. And I think that the third part, you know, kind of speaks to the fact that the messenger does matter. You know, and the truth of the matter is that the messenger matters no matter how educated you are. You know, I was actually not on ARVs for a while. I was always in treatment. And at the point, Carl has heard this story before, but at the point where I decided to go on treatment, now, not to name drop, but to make a point, you know, there are lots of people in my life that I can call. You know, I can call Carl, I can call Tony Fauci, I can call David Ho. And in that case, I actually did call a lot of those people. And I have a great relationship with my doctor. And I got all that information. And then after that, and plus this is what I do, after that, I began to call my friends who are on treatment. And the advice I got from them were as valuable as the advice that I got from the powerful clinicians and researchers that are in my life as well. You know, so the messenger matters. You know, and part of the way that we break through on these trust issues and these access issues is to find out who do people trust, as opposed to try to mold, you know, the relationships of institutions that they may not trust. And building the bridge and creating gatekeepers in that way, we have found to be an effective strategy.
I think the only comment I was going to make is I hadn't been thinking a lot about that trust issue until actually when in our conversation last night, Ken, when you brought that up. And I think that's an important point. The situation, and I agree with everything that Phill just said, I do also think that the people's perception about these products is going to depend in part upon exactly what the product is and what their impression is of people's experience with it to date. So one good thing about Truvada is that it has in fact been widely used. I mean, it's a known quantity, at least to a substantial number of people. As there are newer products, particularly things like long-acting injections, I wonder if that will change. Hopefully not. I mean, the difficult part is that, you know, you never know what people are going to think about what's happening to them when they get an injection. What are you injecting into them? There is a certain proportion of people who are suspicious about that, especially if they hear about, it could only be a few people having some terrible adverse reaction. On the other hand, you know, women are used to getting injections. I mean, this is a known thing. Women get injections for contraception, so it's not that foreign a concept. So I don't know what'll happen. I think we just have to, you know, give it some serious thought and also see what happens. But it's an interesting and important issue.
Great. Yes, please.
Hi, my name is Daniel Pohl from Howard Brown Health Center in Chicago. And having participated in resource allocation in Chicago, it's challenging because prevention among black women is very important to me. And I think when you're talking about how to target black women, I think you mean non-injecting, non-transgender, non-African US black women. Is that who are at risk sexually, Dr. Adimora? Is that right?
I would say that black women in the U.S. at risk are for the most part a population of women who themselves have low income and who live in areas where there are high HIV rates
right.
and high rates of poverty.
Right.
And they may or not, may not be injecting, but most of them tend to acquire it through heterosexual transmission.
Right. I guess what I was trying to do is chip away at people that we can target through needle exchange, which there's not enough of, through programs for transgender women, which there are not enough of, programs for people who are first-generation African, which there are not enough of. But some of the black women in Chicago who are reported among statistics are, in fact, African. So I guess in thinking about targeting, my question, sorry for the preface, which other program do you think would be most high yield for us to leverage, whether it's better partner services, STD control, juvenile justice, substance use, family planning? Where can we make use?
All of those.
Right, exactly.
Great. So we're winding down towards the end of our time. I just wonder if our speakers would have any final thoughts that you'd like to share with the audience. Dr. Dieffenbach?
So I don't mean to be a little crass about this, but we can do the best research in the world, but unless we can solve some of these other problems, we're not going to make progress. And I think that coming back to the president's national HIV/AIDS strategy, it is a bold attempt to try to, at the federal level, to integrate the agencies to get this done. The federal government can't solve all the problems. It's going to require community, it's going to require state and local governments, and ultimately, it's going to ultimately the community is going to have to demand accountability at all levels and from themselves in order to solve these problems.
Great, thank you. Phil?
You know, the National HIV/AIDS strategy was a remarkable document, and when the final throes of actually revising that document is going to be released shortly, I think it's really, really important that those of us who are committed to actually getting to the end game are intimately familiar with the original document as well as the revised document. There's important stuff there. I also think that kind of working on both sides of the equation is important. You know, we don't have anything to take to communities if we don't have the breakthrough science that we're getting. And so that is really, really important. And we need to make sure in all sorts of places and ways that we're communicating that, that we're cheerleading that, that we're acknowledging that. And the truth of the matter is that communities can learn this stuff. You know, one of the things that I didn't talk about earlier is that when we found out that we had the low HIV science literacy in communities, we developed a curriculum to see if we can change that. And what we discovered is the people who have gone through our programs, many of them come in with a baseline knowledge of 57%. And at the end of the year, they are leaving with a baseline knowledge of over 93%. So we can move the needle. And in all of those cases, something like 80% of the folks who actually go through these programs actually are utilizing that information, utilizing that science to actually implement services. So communities can learn it, they can retain it, and they can actually put it to play in their local communities, and we should not forget that.
Great. And Ada, please.
So, you know, I would say that ending the HIV epidemic has obviously multiple components, chief among them being preventing new infections and curing old ones. And, you know, we've obviously come an extraordinarily long way during the past few decades, thanks to the efforts of certainly science and NIH and the community for pushing for it. You know, it is ironic, though, that the reason that we are still in the state we're in really has largely to do with the fact that we have not successfully addressed the social determinants that are really creating and maintaining this situation. And as far as I can tell, that is largely because of lack of political will and the fact that we have really not been anywhere near as successful as we should have been in implementing the things that we already know how to do, that actually don't even take research to figure out that we should do. And I think that's really the problem for us at hand right now, frankly, that all of us should try to figure out how to do something about is the lack of political will that we're really struggling with and that's keeping us back.
Well, we should really thank the panel for a very enlightening and sobering set of presentations. And the good news is that there are many people in this room who are in positions to really affect some changes. So hopefully that's really one of the major goals of the summit, is to stimulate more discussion so that we can get to the next point to take advantage of these scientific developments. I just have a few housekeeping announcements. In the session listings, oral presentations without an abstract number are invited presentations or abstracts that are co-submitted to IAS 2015, and they're under the IAS 2015 embargo until July 22nd. There's a title correction in the B session on prevention in persons living with HIV or HCV. The correct title, the first abstract, is 2014 Recommendations for HIV Prevention with Adults and Adolescents in the U.S., Recommendations from the CDC, HRSA, NIH, and five governmental non-governmental HIV prevention and care organizations. So the sessions now begin immediately in the breakout rooms, breakout room group A is in Regency Ballroom C. For B, it's Potomac 3 and 4. For C is Potomac 5 and 6. And D, Regency Ballroom D. Thank you, everyone.